Jacob's well, the woman of Samaria, the living water, I am the Messiah. It was toward midday when Jesus and the three disciples reached the hill. Jesus sent them onto Sychar to procure food, for he was hungry, while he himself ascended the hill alone to await them. The day was hot, and Jesus was very tired and thirsty. He sat down a short distance from the well on the side of the path that led up from Sychar. Resting his head upon his hand, he seemed to be patiently waiting for someone to open the well and give him to drink. And now I saw a Samaritan woman of about 30 years, a Lethean bottle hanging on her arm, coming up the hill from Sychar to draw water. She was beautiful, and I remarked how briskly and vigorously, and with what long strides she mounted the hill. Her costume appeared somewhat studied, and there was an air of distinction about it. Her dress was striped blue and red, embroidered with large yellow flowers. The sleeves above and below the elbow were fastened by yellow bracelets, and were ruffled at the wrist. She wore a white stomacher ornamented with yellow cords. Her neck was entirely concealed by a yellow woolen collar thickly covered with strings of pearl and coral. Her veil, very fine and long, was woven of some rich, woolen material. It hung down her back, but by means of a string could be drawn together and fastened around her waist. When thus worn, it formed a point behind and on either side folds in which the elbows could comfortably rest. When both sides of the veil were fastened on the breast, the whole of the upper part of her person was enveloped as if in a mantle. Her head was bound with fillets that entirely concealed the hair. From her headdress there arose above the forehead something like a little tower or a crown. Tucked up behind it lay the furry part of the veil which, when let down over her face, reached to the breast. She had her large, brownish goat or camel hair apron with its open pockets, thrown up over her right arm, so that the leather bottle hanging on that arm was partly concealed. This apron was similar to those usually worn at such work as drawing water. It protected the dress from the bucket and water bottle. The bottle was of leather, and like a seamless sack. It was convex on two sides, as if lined with a firm, arched, wooden surface. But the two others, when the bottle was empty, lay together in folds like those of the pocketbook. On the two firm sides were leather-covered handles through which ran a leather strap used for carrying it on the arm. The mouth of the bottle was narrow. It could be opened like a funnel for receiving the contents, and closed again like a work pouch. When empty, the bottle hung flat on the side, but when filled it bulged out, holding as much as an ordinary water bucket. It was under this guise that I saw the woman briskly ascending the hill, to get water from Jacob's well for herself and others. I took a fancy to her right away. She was so kind, so frank, so open-hearted. She was called Dina, in the Roman martyrology she is called Fotina, was the child of a mixed marriage, and belonged to the sect of Samaritans. She lived in Sychar, but it was not her birthplace. Her peculiar circumstances were unknown to the inhabitants, among whom she went by the name of Salome. Both she and her husband were very much liked on account of their open, friendly, and obliging manners. The windings of the path by which she mounted the hill prevented Dina's seeing the Lord until she actually stood before him. There was something startling in the sight as he sat there exhausted and all alone on the path leading to Jacob's well. He wore a long, white robe of fine wool like an alb, bound with a broad girdle. It was a garment such as the prophets wore, and which the disciples usually carried for him. He made use of it only on solemn occasions when he preached, or fulfilled some prophecy. Dina, coming thus suddenly upon Jesus, was startled. She lowered her veil and hesitated to advance, for the Lord was sitting full in her path. I saw passing through her mind the characteristic thoughts, a man. What is he doing here? Is it a temptation? She saw that Jesus was a Jew as, beaming with benevolence, he graciously drew his feet back, for the path was narrow, with the words, "Pass on, and give me to drink." These words touched the woman, since the Jews and the Samaritans were accustomed to exchange only glances of mutual aversion, and so she still lingered, saying, "Why art thou here all alone at this hour? If anyone should happen to see me here with thee, he would be scandalized." To which Jesus answered that his companions had gone on to the city to purchase food. Dina said, "Indeed. The three men whom I met? But they will find little at this hour. What the Sychemites have prepared for today, they need for themselves." She spoke as if it were either a feast or a fast that day in Sychar, and named another place to which they should have gone for food. But Jesus again said, "Pass on, and give me to drink." Then Dina passed by him. Jesus arose and followed her to the well, which she unlocked. While going thither, she said, "How canst thou, being a Jew, ask a drink from a Samaritan?" And Jesus answered her, "If thou didst know the gift of God and who he is that saith to thee, 'Give me to drink,' thou wouldst perhaps have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water." Then Dina loosened the cover and the bucket, meanwhile saying to Jesus, who had seated himself on the rim of the well, "Sir, thou hast nothing wherein to draw, and the well is deep. Whence then hast thou living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well, and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle?" As she uttered these words, I had a vision of Jacob's digging the well and the waters springing up. The woman understood Jesus' words to refer to the water of this well, and so, as she was speaking, she put the bucket on the cylinder, which turned heavily, lowered it and drew it up again. She pushed up her sleeves with the bracelets until they puffed out high above the elbow, and in this way with bare arms she filled her leather bottle out of the bucket. Then, taking a little vessel made of bark and shaped like a horn, she filled it with water and handed it to Jesus, who sitting on the rim of the well drank it and said to her, "Whosoever drinketh of this water, shall thirst again, but he that shall drink of the water that I shall give him, shall not thirst forever. Yes, the water that I will give him, shall become in him a fountain of water springing into life everlasting." Dina replied eagerly, "Sir, give me that living water, that I may no more thirst nor have to come with so much fatigue to draw." She was struck by his words, "living water," and had a presentiment, though without being fully conscious of it, that Jesus meant by the living water the fulfillment of the promise. And so it was under prophetic inspiration that she uttered her heartfelt prayer for that living water. I have always felt and understood that those persons with whom the Redeemer treated are not to be considered as mere individuals. They perfectly represented a whole race of people, and they did so, because they belonged to the plenitude of time. And so in Dina the Samaritan, there stood before the Redeemer the whole Samaritan sect, so long separated from the true faith of Israel, from the fountain of living water. Jesus at the well of Jacob thirsted after the chosen souls of Samaria, in order to refresh them with the living waters from which they had cut themselves off. It was that portion of the rebellious sect still open to salvation that here thirsted after this living water and, in a certain way, reached out an open hand to receive it. Samaria spoke through Dina, "Give me, O Lord, the blessing of the promise. Help me to obtain the living water from which I may receive more consolation than from this temporal well of Jacob, through which alone we still have communication with the Jews." When Dina had thus spoken, Jesus said to her, "Go home, call thy husband, and come back hither." And I heard him give the command twice, because it was not to instruct her alone that he had come. In this command the Redeemer addressed the whole sect, "Samaria, call hither him to whom thou belongest, him who by holy contract is lawfully bound to thee." Dina replied to the Lord, "I have no husband." Samaria confessed to the bridegroom of souls that she had no contract, that she belonged to no one. Jesus replied, "Thou hast said well, for thou hast had five husbands, and he with whom thou now liest is not thy husband. Thou hast spoken truly." In these words the Messiah said to the sect, "Samaria, thou speakest the truth. Thou hast been espoused to the idols of five different nations, and thy present alliance with God is no marriage contract." These words of Jesus refer to the five different pagan colonies with their idolatry, placed by the king of the Assyrians in Samaria after the greater part of its inhabitants had been led into the Babylonian captivity. What remained of the original people of God in Samaria had become mixed up with the heathens and their idol worship. Here Dina, lowering her eyes and hanging her head, answered, "Sir, I see that thou art a prophet," and she drew down her veil. The Samaritan sect recognized the divine mission of the Lord, and confessed its own guilt. As if Dina understood the prophetic meaning of Jesus' words, "And he with whom thou liest is not thy husband," that is, thy actual connection with the true God is imperfect and illegal, the religion of the Samaritans has by sin and self-will been separated from God's covenant with Jacob. As if she felt the deep significance of these words, she pointed toward the south, to the temple not far off on Mount Gerizim, and said questioningly, "Our fathers adored on that mountain, and you say that Jerusalem is the place where men must adore?" Jesus replied with the words, "Woman, believe me, The hour cometh when neither in Gerizim nor in Jerusalem wilt thou adore the Father. In this reply he meant to say, Samaria, the hour cometh when neither here nor in the sanctuary of the temple will God be adored, because he walks in the midst of you. And he continued, you adore that which you know not, but we adore that which we know, for salvation is of the Jews. Here he related to her a similitude of the wild, unfruitful suckers of trees, which shoot forth into wood and foliage, but produce no fruit. It was as if he had said to the sect, Samaria, thou hast not security in thy worship. Thou hast no union, no sacrament, no pledge of alliance, no ark of the covenant, no fruit. The Jews, from whom the Messiah will be born, have all these things, the promise, and its fulfillment. And again Jesus said, but the hour cometh and now is when the true adorers will adore the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father wills such to adore him. God is a spirit, and they that adore him must adore him in spirit, and in truth. By these words the Redeemer meant, Samaria, the hour cometh, yea, it now is, when the Father by true adorers will be honored in the Holy Ghost and in the Son, who is the way and the truth. Then I replied, I know that the Messiah cometh. When he is come, he will tell us all things. In these words here at the well of Jacob, spoke that portion of the Samaritan sect, which might lay some legitimate claim to the promise, I hope for, I believe in the coming of the Messiah. He will help us. Jesus responded, I am he, I who now speak to thee. By this he said to all Samaria that would be converted, Samaria, I came to Jacob's well athirst for thee, thou water of this well. And when thou didst give me to drink, I promised thee living water that would never let thee thirst again. And thou didst, hoping and believing, make known to me thy longing for this water. Behold, I reward thee, for thou hast allayed my thirst after thee by thy desire after me. Samaria, I am the fountain of living water. I who now speak to thee, am the Messiah. As Jesus pronounced the words, I am the Messiah, Dina, trembling with holy joy, gazed at him in amazement. But suddenly recovering herself, she turned and, leaving her water bottle standing in the well open, she fled down the hill to Sychar, to tell her husband and all whom she met what had happened to her. It was strictly forbidden to leave the well of Jacob open, but what cared Dina now for the well of Jacob? What cared she for her bucket of earthly water? She had received the living water, and her loving, joyous heart was longing to pour its refreshing streams over all her neighbors. But as she was hurrying out of the spring house, she ran past the three disciples who had come with the food and had already been standing for some time at a little distance from the door, wondering what their master could have to say for so long with the Samaritan woman. But through reverence for him, they forbore to question. Dina ran down to Sychar and with great eagerness said to her husband and others whom she met on the street, come up to Jacob's well. There you will see a man that has told me all the secret actions of my life. Come, he is certainly the Christ. Meanwhile the three disciples approached Jesus, who was still by the well, and offered him some rolls and honey out of their basket, saying, Master, eat. Jesus arose and left the well with the words, I have meat to eat which you know not. The disciples said to one another, hath any man brought him to eat? And they thought to themselves, did that Samaritan woman give him to eat? Jesus would not stop to eat, but began descending the hill to Sychar. The disciples followed, eating. Jesus said to them as he went on before, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me, that I may perfect his work. By that he meant, to convert the people of Sychar, after whose salvation his soul hungered. He spoke much more to the same purport. When near the city, Dina the Samaritan again appeared hurrying back to meet Jesus. She joined him respectfully, but full of joy and frankness, and Jesus addressed many words to her, sometimes standing still and sometimes moving slowly forward. He unfolded to her all her past life with all the dispositions of her soul. She was deeply moved and promised that both she and her husband would abandon all and follow him. He pointed out to her many ways by which she could do penance for her sins and repair her scandals. Dina was an intelligent woman of some standing in the world, the offspring of a mixed marriage, a Jewish mother and a pagan father, born upon a country seat near Damascus. She had lost her parents at an early age, and had been cared for by a dissolute nurse by whom her evil passions had been fostered. She had had five husbands one after another. Some had died of grief, others had been put out of the way by her new lovers. She had three daughters and two half-grown sons, all of whom had remained with the relatives of their respective fathers when their mother was obliged to leave Damascus. Dinah's sons at a later period joined the 72 disciples. The man with whom she was now living was a relative of one of her former husbands. He was a rich merchant. As Dinah followed the Samaritan religion, she had induced the man to remove to Sychar, where she superintended his household and lived with him, though without being espoused to him. They were looked upon in Sychar as a married couple. The husband was a vigorous man of about 36 years with a ruddy face and a reddish beard. There were many things in Dinah's life similar to those of Magdalene's, but she had fallen more deeply than the latter. Still, I once saw that in the beginning of Magdalene's evil career at Magdalen, one of her lovers lost his life at the hand of a rival. Dinah was an uncommonly gifted, open-hearted, easily influenced, pleasing woman of great vivacity and impetuosity, but she was always disturbed in conscience. She was living now more respectably, that is with this her reputed husband, in a house that stood alone and surrounded by a moat, near the gate leading from Sychar to the spring house. Though not held in contempt by the inhabitants, still they did not have much communication with her. Her manners were different from theirs, her costume elaborate and studied, or which, however, they pardoned in her as she was a stranger. While Jesus was speaking with Dinah, the disciples followed at some distance, wondering what he could have to say to the woman. "We have brought him food, and that with a good deal of difficulty. Why, now, does he not eat?" When near Sychar, Dinah left the Lord and hurried forward to meet her husband and many of the citizens, who came pouring out of their houses, all curiosity to see Jesus. Full of joy, they exulted and shouted salutations of welcome to him. Jesus, standing still, motioned with his hand for silence, and addressed them kindly for some moments, telling them among other things to believe all that the woman had told them. Jesus was so remarkably gracious in his words, his glance was so bright and penetrating that all hearts beat more quickly, all were borne toward him, and they were instant in their solicitations for him to enter and teach in their city. He promised that he would do so, but for the present passed on. This scene took place somewhere between 3 and 4 o'clock in the afternoon. While Jesus was thus addressing the Samaritans outside the gate, or the other disciples, among them Peter, who in the morning had gone on commissions in a different direction, returned to their master. They were surprised and not any too well pleased to see him talking so long with the Samaritans. They felt somewhat embarrassed at it, for they had been reared in the preconceived idea that they were to have no communication with these people, consequently they had never before seen anything like this. They felt tempted to take scandal at it. They reflected upon the hardships of yesterday and the day before, on all the scorn and insult, on the cruel treatment that they had endured. They had expected an easier time, since the women of Bethany had advanced so much money for that end. Seeing now this intercourse with the Samaritans, they thought to themselves it was certainly no wonder when things went on in this way that they were not better received. Their heads were always full of extravagant, worldly fancies of the kingdom that Jesus was to establish, and they thought if all this should become known in Galilee, they would indeed be derided. Amen.